Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know what your views are on this controversial topic. I'm not talking about alcohol or homosexuality in the church. I'm talking about dance in the church. I had some bad skirmishes with some elders in my younger days when I could dance a little bit. But the best dance that I could do was what I'd watched with N.T. Ramarao doing in some of his movies. It was more like exercise, like the PT teacher that you were almost becoming. And so I had an elder admonishing me, saying, "Church lella dance panranga, that action song ella panranga." But so that was my last and final skirmish with dance. But last year in Hyderabad, we have this competition called Champs for Christ, and it's a very popular Sunday school competition. We introduced choreography. It was amazing. We had 120 entries from different churches, and then I realized that dance is a popular medium. And to convince you in the best possible way, I'm just going to call upon Richard David Tholoor.
Richard David Tholoor. I'm from Bangalore, and I am an entertaining dancer. For lack of a better word, you can call me dancertainer. But I wasn't always like this. In fact, when I was younger, I was an introvert. I used to read a lot of books, and my world was Enid Blyton, Nancy Drew, Hardy Boys, Dungeons and Dragons. This problem of being an introvert got so bad that I actually stopped talking to people. Very few people I would talk to. By 10th grade, I had stopped communicating with my mother. I never really danced before, till I was about 17. My first experience with dancing was actually at a girls' college. So they had a cultural festival called Kala in Mount Carmel's College in Bangalore, and they had a small discotheque there. So I went into the discotheque, and I saw one guy who was in our group. He did something like this. And these were the popular moves back then. And all the girls were actually looking at him. So in the mind of a young 17-year-old boy, I thought to myself, hey, if you want to get attention from girls, hey, you got to dance. So I promptly went home, went back to my room, put on the television, and then I used to see MTV Grind. You know, people were dancing, Michael Jackson, and you know, they were doing moves I used to imitate. And at home, my mom and grandmom thought I had gone crazy. Because till then, the word dance wasn't even in my vocabulary. So the scene back home was like this. I would walk to my room to, you know, flip on the TV, practice dancing. And my mom and grandmom used to sit like this while I was walking past. And they used to nudge each other like this. And they used to say, look, 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 the coat hanger is going to dance. Meaning, I looked like a coat hanger, you know, like a suit, very stiff up here like this. Of course, now I have a little bit more flexibility because I practiced hard. I practiced really hard. And I became a good dancer. And then I started competing and representing India at various international salsa championships. This was all before I knew Christ, by the way. And I competed at the European Australian Salsa Championship. I was the first Indian to represent India at the World Salsa Championship. I won first place in these things. Don't have to clap now. Yeah, because we want to clap for Jesus. We don't want to clap for my achievements. Thank you very much. Yeah, so anyway, so I represented India at this World Salsa Championship. And what happened back then was I didn't realize there was something missing inside of me. So this was about the age of 30. And I had all these titles, but I was a different person on the inside. I used to smoke 30 cigarettes a day. My relationship with my mother had deteriorated. For 10 years, we barely spoke to each other. I would go home, light my cigarette in the living room. She would come and give me dinner. Dinner was over, I never spoke to her. Went back inside my room, smoke my cigarette, wake up the next morning and go for dancing again. Didn't speak for 10 years. And I was also obsessed with dancing. I would only talk about dancing to anyone, and I could not understand why people were not as passionate about dancing as I was. And so this was the state of things. And then one day, something happened. I met Jesus on the sets of a television show, India's Got Talent. And this was a sort of unusual place to meet Jesus, because normally we hear about meeting Jesus in church. Someone prayed for you, that sort of thing. But my partner, just to give you a little history of how I got there, my partner had broken her leg a year ago. And then a year later, we decided to make our comeback. So our comeback was on this television show, India's Got Talent. And so we did the quarterfinals, did good. We did the semifinals, did better. We got to the finals. And then she was experiencing this really, really, really hard pain in her leg. In fact, when we used to practice for the finals, she would cry within a minute. And we could not complete the routine, we couldn't practice. And so at that point of time, it was a big thing because they only choose finalists once. Every year they look for fresh talent. So it was like a matter of like a couple of days and we didn't even know if we're going to be able to perform. At that point of time, my mother called me up and she prayed for me. And she was in Bangalore and I was in Mumbai. And as she started praying, I suddenly felt another presence in the room. It was like a real person in the room. In fact, I remember the hair on my forearm standing up, and my worry sort of disappeared, and a sense of calm came over. Now, till then, I was an outstanding Christian, meaning I stood outside the church while all church activities went on. And then the next day, what happened is, me and my partner, Sneha, we just said a short prayer, and we went and we completed the entire performance without making any mistake. And just to show you that this is what I'm doing is, maybe you saw me dance this sort of thing, but what I actually do is I'm a salsa dancer. I'm a professional salsa dancer, and I specialize in salsa acrobatics, meaning I lift the girl, I toss her down, she flips over. And so basically, this is not possible without practice. And the most miraculous part about this was, even after the performance, her leg was still broken. So she was able to perform that. Let me show you a little video of the performance, then you'll understand more what I'm doing. You can watch the screen.
Very well done.
So As you can see, doing something like that is not possible with a broken leg. At that point of time, I realized that this was a supernatural invention. There was a God, and he could intervene by his power. So I went back to Bangalore, and my mom explained a little bit about Jesus Christ, and then I recommitted my life to Christ. And before I got baptized again, I used to smoke 30 cigarettes a day, just remember that. I decided to fast for a day. And during that fast, I decided I won't smoke, because it seemed weird to pursue God and not eat and then, you know, quickly go out for a ciggy break and then come back and, you know, say, you know, do that thing. Seemed weird in my mind, right? So I did that, got baptized the next day, and I just felt normal, came back, put the cigarette in my mouth because it had been a day, and then I started smoking. And the tobacco actually tasted like there was water in it. Tasted horrible. So I threw the cigarette, picked up another one, same taste. And God had supernaturally removed that desire to smoke in a day. And to be honest, I used to smoke 30 cigarettes a day. And I once calculated, you know, how many cigarettes this was in 10 years. 30 cigarettes into 30 days is 90 cigarettes. 90 cigarettes into 1 month, I'm sorry, 900 cigarettes into 1 year, 12 months is like 10,800. 10 years, multiply that into 10, it's over a lakh of cigarettes. 10 years and just 1 second underneath and coming out. So it's just basically, you know, God was showing me just, he has to touch your life for a second for it to change. And now once that happened, I really knew, okay, now God is speaking to me, he's working. I need to follow his will and find out more about him. The problem was I was a salsa dancer. And the word salsa dancing and, you know, Christian, they don't exactly go together. So I thought to myself, like, okay, I'm going to quit salsa dancing. And I did for a period of 6 to 8 months. And then God showed me the ropes about praise dancing, dancing in churches, sharing my testimony, and he even blessed me. I never had any connections with leaders or churches, but I ministered to, I think, like 40 or 50,000 people. I would be sitting in a restaurant, and then there would be a pastor next to me who would tell me to come and, you know, talk in his church. And then somehow I got connected with some people who were organizing the Paul Wilbur concert, Don Moen concert, and then we got a praise dance team from across Bangalore and performed to thousands of people. So God gave me an education, and I thought, okay, I'm dancing now. I'm dancing in churches. I'm following God's purpose for my life. And then one day, a prophet came to our church, and he found out I was a salsa dancer, and he turned to me and he said, you should go and be the light in the darkness. God made you a salsa dancer, so go and be a salsa dancer. And I considered it for a while, and then I prayed, and I restarted my salsa dancing career. And so I just want to share these couple of testimonies in my journey as a salsa dancer for Christ. And I want to also encourage us that just in the normal course of our life, in our daily activities, God is working out his internal purpose if we allow him and if we are following him and listening to his voice. So you don't need to be like anybody else. You need to be like who God made you to be. So my first testimony is on the sets of Entertainment Ke Liye Kuch Bhi Karega. It's a television show where it basically, for entertainment, you can do anything. And this was backstage. I was in the green room. And the green room can be a really chaotic place. So many contestants, all the costume guys are trying to get the contestants ready. There's food coming in. The backstage people are trying to get everybody ready on time. It's quite chaotic. And there's this one taekwondo guy who had a leg pain. When he had I saw that, and then we got into a conversation, and I prayed for him. By God's grace, healing happened, and you know, he was very happy, and then I prayed with his whole taekwondo team. So they were Christians, so it was all right. The next day, again, I was in the green room. And this time, there were a whole bunch of different contestants. And this time, there was a guy, he was dressed up in a sari, he had a blouse, and his job was basically like he's going to dance like a woman on the show, entertainment ke liye kuch bhi karega. So I thought to myself, like, you know, I just have to find a way to pray with this guy. So I went up to him, tapped him on the shoulder. He spoke Hindi, I spoke English, but you know, like, I just said, would you like me to pray for you? I'll just pray for your performance. Okay, anyway, he didn't understand what I was saying. So I prayed for him. And after I prayed for him, he got up, and then his partner, who also had a child, came and sat down in the same place. He said, you pray for me also. This is all in the green room. So then I prayed for these two, and then they got up, and like that, 6 to 7 or 8 people started coming and sitting down for prayer. I mean, God was doing his thing. So in the front of the television sets, shooting was going on. Backstage in the green room, God's service, his Holy Spirit is ministering, is going on. And I still remember the last guy that I prayed for. He came up, he held my hand, and he said, you know, I have bad luck. And he looked very down, upset. And I just said a word of prayer for him, and he spoke Hindi, I spoke English, and I mean, he really didn't speak English, you know, that sort of thing. And so I left it at that. A couple of months later, I went for another television show, Guinness World Records, Ab India Thorega. So I walked in, and then suddenly there's this guy came and held my hand. And then he said to me, you remember me? And it took me a second to remember him. It was the last guy that I had prayed for. And he said this to me. He said, you know, after you prayed for me, I went back to Punjab, and then I won the National Stuntman of the Year Award for Punjab. Just yesterday, I came here and I broke 2 Guinness World Records. But the most amazing part was this. He told me that God had spoken to him in Punjab, saying that he would meet me on this show, and he had brought a Bible as proof to show that, you know, God had spoken to him. So this amazing thing just happened through the daily course of life. You know, you never know when God is orchestrating something just through our daily activity. You can imagine David, right? David was going to give lunch, but he slays Goliath. So never discount what you're doing, when you're doing it, where you're doing it. God can move in any situation. So this was a story of God orchestrating events. Now, in our daily workplace, we can be intentional actually about bringing the kingdom of God and sharing God. So I run a salsa dancing class. This is my daily activity. So people come, they normally like very frustrated software engineers, you know, had a hard time at work, and they find a release in the class, meaning like they have fun, they can express themselves, they keep fit. And normally we just teach them dancing. And after the dance class, I make it a point to say a very short prayer with them. 10 seconds, sometimes 20 seconds. God bless them, keep them. If anybody is looking for a job, we pray, oh God, that you would provide for it. Simple prayer in Jesus' name. And so what happened was, after I started praying, people used to come back with stories. They used to ask, say, like, you know, like you prayed last time for a job, like how did you know? What is this about Jesus? And people were actually getting blessed by the prayers. And I still remember this one story of this guy. He came to find out if he could perform at an event I was going for. He came for the event, he found out the details, and then he said, could you do me a favor, Richard? Could you tell me more about Jesus? And so I said, I was busy in class at that point, so I told him to speak to my mom. That guy actually went and got baptized. And like that, from my normal salsa class, 12 to 13 people have gotten baptized over the last, I think like, I don't know how many years, 7 years that I've been doing this salsa classes. 12 to 13 people have actually gotten baptized. So this is like a popular joke. If they don't come to church, just send them to the salsa class, you know. I'm just kidding. Please take the folks to church, okay? Yeah. But anyway, we should be providing opportunities with whatever skills we have for people to know about Christ. That's the way God wants us to be. Salsa dancer, comedian, anybody, anything. God can use anybody and anything. I'd like to share one last testimony. Now, this is a testimony of God's provision. Because, you know, like, in our jobs, we sometimes are, like, pursuing, you know, a title, a position, and sometimes even profit. But these are things that are added unto us when we seek God's kingdom. And it's good. It's good to set a goal. You know, I want to be like this. But you do it by looking at Jesus. That's the important part. So I just want to share one small testimony of how I was blessed financially. And this was at a point of time where I just started the salsa classes again. And after I had taken that break to only do praise dancing, my money had sort of like run out. And I actually needed finances. And so I was taking class, and my mom was praying for me outside. And she was praying over the scripture again and again. Save us now, O Lord, send now prosperity. She was just praying that again. She suddenly gets a call from a lady. And she says, we would like Richard to take salsa classes in this corporate. So I thought to myself, oh, okay, 20 to 25 students are going to show up. You know, God is answering. Like it was like a monthly bread, you could say. Daily bread, monthly bread. It was a monthly bread for us, all right? So I was happy. And then she said that she had met me when I was she had seen me when I was dancing in one of the Christian programs. And I said, okay, let's go. And I went there. And normally it's 25, 50 students is good. In fact, the most number of students I've had is about 250 students. This is after working for 10 years continuously, you know, to build it up. And now just starting from scratch again. So I went there and she said, okay, registrations are happening on this day. After a couple of days, she gives me a call. She said, Richard, we're going to have to open two batches. 225 students have registered for your class. And that's actually an amazing thing. You could manage like a whole year if 225 students actually come for your dance class, just from teaching for 3 months. So just want to encourage you about not just pursuing profit for profit, because it's the Holy One of Israel who teaches you the manner and the way that you should go in order to be profitable. And the idea of God's profitability is not just in money. It's you should be valuable to people. Okay? So I'm closing with a little dance. It's actually the first dance that I've ever done for the Lord. It's not as complicated as you see all those moves, but it's very special to me because it conveys a meaning to people, right? So this is a song about praising God in advance.
I've had my share of ups and downs, times when there was no one around. God came and spoke these words to me. Praise will confuse the enemy. Life and mercy.
But I knew God would take you away.
Let's appreciate Richard David Tholoor. What a beautiful dancer for God. Richard, don't go anywhere. Please just stay there. In a little while, I'm going to ask you to teach us just one step that we can practice at lunch, that we can do in our church tomorrow. But Princely and Jerusha are here to give you a memento that you were here at LeadTalks Chennai 2018. And the word says, holy groove. That's what the pun says. Richard David Tholoor, holy groove. Thank you, Richard. You are amazingly fit for a man who had more smoke in you than a chimney. You're amazingly fit. Just amazing what you do, and praise God for your... What did you say?
I said I'm 38 as well.
You're 38. I would never have guessed. I would have never guessed. That's just a little older than me, but maybe about 20 years older than me. But thank you, Richard. Before we go for lunch, if you can, I'll hold this thing. I won't take it. Just one step, maybe. Something that we can practice at lunch. And sorry for putting you on the spot. Any praise music or just a step, something that we can practice at lunch. Just one thing. And maybe you guys can try it at church tomorrow. Don't get thrown out. Don't become an outstanding Christian like Rajiv. Who was the outstanding Christian?
Okay.
That was you. Okay.
Let's do a fun step, all right? Let's do the I love Jesus step. Is that okay?
Yeah. So all you have to do is look up, okay, and say, I love Jesus. Now stand up.
Stand up and do it.
All right. Can I stand here? Is that okay? You can stay down. It'll be easy. All right. Now 5, 6, 7, go. Now go. Anyone can provide a beat. Okay. Now just kidding. All right. So lead to the left. I bounce, 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 bounce. Love. Bounce, 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 bounce. Jesus. Bounce, bounce, bounce. Now let's go. 5, 6, 7, go. I love Jesus. Now say it loudly. 5. I want you guys to say it loudly. 5, 6, 7, go. I love Jesus. Now shout and clap. Whoa!
That was beautiful. I couldn't do it. I had an excuse. I was holding the thing. I would have done it better than him. But you can try it in church tomorrow. We go for lunch now. A couple of announcements. Thank you, Richard. And yes, I almost forgot giving that to you. Holy groove. No, no, no. Thank you so much.